Welcome back to the Art Channel, and this week we're going to be reviewing a show called History Is Now, which is being mounted by the Hayward Gallery on London's South Bank. And the curators have arranged this show to coincide with the upcoming general election in Britain, which will take place in May. This show runs until the 26th of April, and the curators have invited six artists to curate a section on the theme of History Is Now. And those artists are John Akonfra, Simon Fujiwara, Roger Hjorns, Hannah Starkey, Richard Wentworth, and Jane and Louise Wilson, who work together. And this show is quite intriguing and challenging because it's divided into these six sections where the artists are working as curators. Sometimes it will include some of their own material, but primarily they're working with found objects that relate to the theme of the exhibition. They're using the work of other artists. So what's fundamental about this exhibition is how the artist can operate as a curator to bring artifacts together to tell a particular story around politics and identity in Britain today and in the past.
So as Josh says, it's a big show. It is in six sections, and we're going to look at three of those sections. The first of which is a section by an artist called Simon Fujiwara, who confronts you with plinths, with objects, iconic and unknown objects, at eye level. So you wander through these kind of blocks with objects on top of them. They're arranged in kind of rows, and there's a relationship between pieces that sit next to each other. There's a very interesting piece called Clink, which is actually very simple and quite humorous. It's a place setting for dinner, and this is from a prison which runs a training unit in London for young men to become chefs, to become cooks. And so the place that you can go and have dinner at the Clink. The cutlery is black plastic. The napkins are dark blue. It's very functional. It feels very much like prison wear. And next to it, there are a kind of upmarket pair of salad servers designed by Nigella Lawson. So there's a nice and funny link, materials-wise and consumerist-wise, I think, between the two objects.
Yes, and besides that piece on a plinth is a work by Pablo Bronstein, an Argentinian-British artist, and he makes these very beautiful drawings that draw on this interest in nostalgia, which of course is a particular sort of character, arguably, of Britain. And so he's designed or drawn this prison in the style of a 17th century Baroque building. And so you have this kind of humorous clash of function with aesthetics. And it's just tremendously playful. And then we move to another plinth, and there are simply wrappers, empty wrappers, for a range of herbs produced by Waitrose, the supermarket. So you can see how he's playing with eclectic contrasts and juxtapositions, have this sort of jarring quality. So it's quite free-flowing, it's almost like a sort of stream of consciousness of objects that have some kind of relationship with wider politics and society and identity.
I think that section is very successful in that it's very accessible, it's quite humorous, but it also tackles politics, the idea of riot, of unrest. And they're recognisable objects, and it is very much a set of portraits of Britain, and they work as a whole, I think.
The next section we want to focus on is an area dedicated to a selection of pieces chosen by Roger Hjorns, a British artist in his 30s. And he takes one theme, which is the progression of BSC, or otherwise known as the mad cow disease. This kind of tragic development, progression of an illness in animals from contaminated feed, which unfortunately infects several consumers of beef. And all of the kind of accompanying outcry and panic that takes place in the media. And so it's very much a kind of archival display whereby he's sourcing official documents and news reports in the newspapers, but he's also including some artworks, notably two heads of cows made by Damien Hirst, and also a work made by Ligier Clark, a Brazilian artist who makes these beautiful little sculptural handheld objects that can be constantly manipulated and altered. And there's an analogy really with kind of cellular development or cells that go awry.
It's an interesting section, it's complicated, and it's a very small part of what the artist calls his research. And as you say, there are there's images, there are bits of newsreel footage which are quite disturbing, there are personal accounts of the disease, and the whole thing is punctuated by quite iconic, astonishing pieces of artwork. So there are some Thomas Weaver engravings from the 1800s, looking at Britain as a kind of rural idyll, this producer of fantastic animals, fantastic beef, moving right through to the Damien Hirst with these two stripped down heads, still disturbing after 30 years in their little vitrines. And as you say, in the middle of the Lydia Clark is absolutely beautiful, this little metal critter which can be reconfigured and sits in the landscape, was designed to sit in a rural landscape. So it's a complicated, it's a very interesting exhibition within an exhibition.
And there's the touch of the personal, as you mentioned, there's a letter from a mother commemorating, it's the speech she gave at her son's funeral, where she pays tribute to him and of course expresses her dismay at his tragic death from this horrible illness. And then we move upstairs.
So the last section we wanted to look at, and actually the last section in the show, is curated, put together by Richard Wentworth, a British sculptor who really came to the fore, I guess, in the 1970s and 80s. And he looks very much, I think, at post-war Britain and post-war development and optimism and the idea of utopia in Britain after the Second World War. And one of those striking pieces that you come across when you come around the corner is by Tony Cragg, and it's called Map of Britain from the North. It has a figure and Britain on its side, on the wall, and it's a kind of collage of detritus, of plastic bottles, bits of cardboard, and it's still, we were saying, very fresh after all that time. The figure is life-size and you can get close up to it, and it's also incredibly beautiful. It's full of primary colours, it's a quite astonishing piece.
Yes, it's it invites you to consider Britain from a new geographical and, by extension, new political angle. But he's also, as a sculptor, proposing the way in which he can use junk materials and reconfigure them, and in the context of art, in the context of sculpture. And then we go outside to the terrace, where Richard Wentworth has sourced a Bloodhound missile, a whole missile unit, which was a system devised in the 1950s and 1960s to protect Britain against Russian aerial bombardment. And it's a very confronting, disturbing piece of technology, because you can appreciate its power and devastating potential to really bring down planes and kill people.
It is quite odd to be standing by the window. You look out of the window with a view across the river, across central London, and as you say, you know, 3 or 4 metres from you is this very frightening object. And I think it links into a lot of the things in the exhibition. There is a lot about green, about social unrest, about political unrest, particularly through the 1980s. And I think that crystallises a lot of the concerns from many of the artists working in the show.
And I loved the Richard Wentworth section. It was the most sort of thoughtful and creative in terms of using that material to explore recent British history and identity. It uses archival material, including the obituary of the chief engineer who designed the missile, who apparently dismissed art and music as a waste of time. You see a beautiful panel designed by Ben Nicholson for the Festival of Britain that took place on the South Bank in that particular site. It addresses all of those kind of hopes and fears and struggles of post-war Britain, and Britain trying to find a new place in the world after this experience of the Second World War. And so it does carry optimism as well as a sense of defeat, of goals not perhaps being met.
Yeah, I think there's an honesty in some of the people in there. There's Reg Butler, there's Henry Moore, and they are looking at the aftermath, the terrible questions that came out of the Second World War. So it is it's a good look at history without being very dogmatic.
And there's a very nice little example of the material of the pebbles that Henry Moore found in the fields around his home in March Haddam in Hertfordshire, because he uses the forms of the stones as inspiration for some of his post-war sculpture. And there's that kind of humanist reaffirmation of art and of culture and of human potential. So that's very successful, but I do have some problems with the show because it's trailed as an exhibition that addresses Britain today and the issues that are going to arise out of this pivotal political event, namely the general election, which will take place in 12 weeks from now.
Yes, I think it feels much more nostalgic than it should. I think these are artists looking back at their own careers, looking back at seminal points in their careers. It's six little exhibitions within one, and there's not enough thought about what's going on right now. I mean, I think the most recent piece of work in the exhibition is possibly 2011. Mm. So I would have wanted it to come bang up to date and ask some current questions.
That's right. So, all in all, it's quite a difficult exhibition, it's thought-provoking, it's quite difficult to navigate, to make sense of it. There are many films that demand considerable time to watch. But all in all, it's a very lively show,
even if it's not entirely successful. It's definitely worth a visit, yeah.
So thank you for watching the Art Channel this week, and please do join us next week.
Thank you.